So the first question we have is, can a DRE performed before a PSA test in any way affect the results of the PSA test?
It certainly can. Anything that has impacted the prostate gland can raise PSA levels. DREs right before drawing the blood, sometimes people, for reasons unknown to me, will check their PSA after they've had a biopsy. Biopsies where people get their prostates poked with needles can keep PSA levels high for as long as 2 months afterwards. Recent sexual activity within a day or two can cause the PSA to be high. We do ultrasounds in the office, pushing on the prostate, and then drawing a PSA right after that can cause the PSA to go up. So accurate PSA testing requires that people withhold these activities for a day or two before they test for PSA.
So if a person goes in and the doctor wants to do a PSA test that day right after they've had a DRE, you would suggest that they come back and do the PSA test a couple days later?
That's reasonable. You can test because the PSA won't always be high, but it can be high. So if the PSA comes back normal, it's fine. But if it's elevated, you're going to wonder, is it because something's going on or is it because of the recent digital rectal exam?
Our next question is regarding hormone therapy. So it's a hormone therapy called Erleada. And first of all, can you explain what Erleada is? And then also, does it help suppress a growing PSA?
Hormone therapies, of which Erleada is one, definitely will suppress PSA in most cases. There are some exceptions. Erleada is a second generation hormone medicine that works inside the cancer cell. It was realized 10, 15 years ago that hormone-resistant prostate cancer, that means people who have cancers that aren't responding to Lupron, come about because certain cancer cells learn how to make their own testosterone. And Erleada works inside the cancer cell to block the testosterone's activity there and brings the cancer back under control again.
So for a man who maybe is now failing Lupron, would you say Erleada is the first line for him to take out of the second generation, or does it matter really just on how the doctor's prescribing?
Well, it's an excellent choice. There's other agents such as Provenge, which will often administer Provenge first and then start Erleada, or one of the other second-generation hormone medicines like Xtandi or Nubeqa or Zytiga. But yeah, they're all very effective in that role.
So Provenge is interesting because it's not a hormone therapy, it's an immune therapy. So how does that work to fight cancer?
People describe it sort of like a cancer vaccine, which that's something that lay people understand. Vaccinations where the immune system is awakened to a new target, and Provenge takes immune cells out of a patient's bloodstream, the memory cells, and awakens them to an antigen on the surface of the cancer cells called PAP. And then once those memory cells have been awakened to the presence of this antigen, which is on the surface of cancer cells, these cells are reinfused, and then they awaken the patient's immune system to attack the cancer.
So just to summarize, when a patient is now failing Lupron or finasteride, and we see this a lot in different cases, they need to talk to the doctor about Provenge. And then if they're going to choose hormone therapy, they need to kind of go through those options of whether it's Erleada or Xtandi or Nubeqa or anything like that.
Yeah, our usual sequence is if people develop a rising PSA on Lupron, get a PSMA PET scan. Many of the insurance companies require to demonstrate some metastasis somewhere. Most of these patients will have a lymph node or something like that. If a single metastasis is found, we'll probably radiate the lymph node, start some Provenge right after that. And the Provenge is done in 6 weeks, and then we'll start the Erleada or the second generation hormone therapy subsequent to that.
Now, I appreciate that you mentioned the lymph node, because I think a lot of people, when they think about metastasis and they go get a scan, they don't think about lymph nodes being a metastasis versus maybe just bone metastasis. And so a lot of these people are qualifying, but they don't know that it's available to them. So I appreciate that definition. Hey everyone, it's me, Alex, and our mascot, Hunter. You can check out his Instagram, Sir Hunter the Dow, at the link below. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, and in fact, if this dog high fives me, high five, high five. Can you high five me? Thank you. You have to subscribe. Go subscribe to the YouTube channel. He even thinks it's awesome. Also, don't forget to visit our website, PCRI.org.